We can speak to Sir Richard Branson, who joins us from Necker Island in the Caribbean. Sir Richard, a very warm welcome to you. This is a story which, for obvious reasons, has generated global headlines, but at the very heart of it is a personal tragedy for the crew of two on board this vehicle. Let's talk about Peter Sebald to start with, who seems to have ejected to safety. What's his condition?
Well, he didn't actually eject, as has been said in the press. But fortunately, he did get out and he did get his parachute open. And I'm delighted to say that there's nothing too seriously wrong with him. And I think he'll hopefully be back walking out of hospital in the next few days.
Yeah, and I suppose it goes without saying that what he can tell investigators, tell you and the people who work with you and have been working with you for years now, will help shed some light on precisely what happened. What's your developing sense of the cause of this crash?
Well, my hands are completely tied by the NTSB, who are doing the investigation and are doing an incredibly thorough investigation, and quite rightly, they don't want me to start speculating, and ideally, they don't want the press to start speculating until they've got facts. I mean, this weekend in the UK, I've never seen so much, to be perfectly frank, irresponsible innuendo and damaging innuendo that was written, and was grateful for the NTSB to come out very strongly last night to say that the fuel tanks, the engine, were completely intact, which would mean that there was no explosion that caused it, despite a lot of self-proclaimed experts saying that was the cause. So what we must do is just listen to the NTSB, who are doing a thorough investigation, and let them come out and let us all know exactly what caused it, and then we will certainly learn from it, make sure it never happens again, and move forward.
It's undeniable, certainly, isn't it, that reading the coverage over the weekend, a lot of people were putting two and two together. They say, don't they, that assuming anything can be a very dangerous business in journalism, as elsewhere. But sometimes people were making a connection or suggesting that, I'll put it more plainly than this, that some of the engineers or some of the more high-profile staff involved in the project had walked off the job or felt uncomfortable with the project. It was reported and suggested because of their misgivings about safety. Can you debunk those reports for us?
Yeah, I mean, it was incredibly hurtful to the 400 engineers who have worked so gallantly at Virgin Galactic, and also to all the wonderful engineers who work at Scaled, who were the actual manufacturer of the spaceship. It was insulting, and I think the NTSB. They could have actually, if the press had actually looked at the photographs, they would have seen full fuel tanks and engine all intact on the ground, and yet they were talking about massive explosion. They were having pictures of the explosion. They were talking about people ejecting out of the plane in ejector seats. We don't have ejector seats. It was British press at its worst, to be honest. And I think some of them should hang their heads in shame. I mean, the rest of the world's press did not do that, and the public were incredibly supportive. And by and large, I think the television, played it absolutely straight. Some aspects of the British press and some of the more serious aspects should I think ask some questions of themselves.
I suppose here's a question, Sir Richard. Part of the problem is, as you well know, as we know here too, that where the media are concerned, you can't turn it on and off like a tap. You've got no choice in the matter. And a big part of Galactic's business model is generating publicity. At the end of the day, it's designed to be, pushing the cutting edge of science, yes, but also a business model which relies on tourism. And to attract tourism, you need good press. Now, clearly, we can all agree, can't we, that this has not been good press. What has this done to your business model, bearing in mind you suggesting, and this is a matter of record, that we could have people in space, as space tourists, by 2008, perhaps 2009 at the latest?
I once said that if we had an accident, once we'd actually, you know, started carrying passengers in the early days, it would be very difficult to recover from that. Mm. I think that hopefully that this is slightly different in that we had test pilots testing the spacecraft in extreme situations to make sure that it was safe for passengers. I think that once the public know what happened, again, I cannot speculate. Mm. That obviously what happened has been either put right or it's clear what happened. I think we can move forward. We have spent many years building a spacecraft, a mothership, a spaceport that I think can do the job and can do the job safely. But we will not start taking people until we've finished a whole massive series of test flights, and until myself and my family have gone up, and until we feel that we can safely say to people we're ready to go.
The inevitable question people will ask when you say that it's still your intention to fly yourself, to take family members with you, is whether you're recalibrating that calculation. In the light of recent events, are you still committed to that course of action?
All I can say is that we will not fly family members. Well, sorry, we will not fly members of the public unless we can fly myself and family members. So, we need to be absolutely certain that our spaceship has been thoroughly tested, and that it will be. And once it's thoroughly tested and ready to go to space, we will go to space. I mean, if when the comet exploded back in the 1920s, which my mother was nearly on board, she was an air stewardess on the comet. If we'd stopped flying pressurized planes back in the 1920s, and that was a fault with pressurization in the window, we wouldn't have had the Boeing 747. So, we must push on, and there is incredible things that can happen through mankind being able to explore space properly. Putting big arrays of satellites. Sorry.
I just wonder whether, I mean, people will be sympathetic to that. I imagine many people will. But they will also wonder whether the risk-benefit ratio has shifted. You know, I mean, as you say, your spaceport not far from where the right stuff was happening in the 60s and the 70s. And people were taking what now we would view as tremendous, daft risks, really, but essential for the space program, which then followed on, and the great flourishing that followed on from that. You're convinced that the risks are still worth it. Are you worried that the culture within which you work will be supportive?
I've seen the literally hundreds of letters and emails from people who signed up to go to space with us. I've seen emails from two people who signed up to go to space with us on the day of the accident, in 100% support of what we're trying to do. And I think there's been overwhelming global support, despite what some elements have written in the British press. There's been unbelievable support. So I'm absolutely convinced that Virgin Galactic has a great future. I think that once the NTSB has made it very clear exactly what happened, I think that support would be even the stronger.
Well, Sir Richard, I know we're about to lose our satellite link to you in the Caribbean, but we do appreciate you coming on this morning to explain some of the context for this tragedy. Thank you very much indeed. Sir Richard Branson there.